Hi guys, welcome. Thanks for joining me today. I know I was on a little bit of a hiatus. I know that, let's see, I think Anish and Mike took over the last 2 weeks, but I'm back. I'm back in full effect. I'm wearing yellow because I'm happy and I'm still in Florida. It's my last 2 weeks here. So, and I made myself an iced coffee, which is really just hot coffee poured over ice with some cream and almond milk. I know the two don't really, it's kind of weird, but I don't have a lactose problem. So there's that. Anyway, hi, welcome to Coffee with Corey. What is this? What is the show? It is a show that TBI produces. We are a technology services distributor. And every week I introduce you to a technology supplier. I'm Corey Cohen. So I'm the host and traditionally I'm the vice president of marketing, but, news, I am changing my role to vice president of partner experience. So I'm switching gears and doing things that I love, like putting together revenue generating programs with both suppliers and our partners to help our partners generate more sales and grow their business. And before I get into it, like I said, I'm very excited to talk to our guest today because we share some commonalities. But what can I say other than being in Florida and it being 90 degrees and yet I'm still wearing long sleeves? I had a bet with my husband whether Chicago was going to get to 50 degrees, and it is. This is what I've heard. And so I feel like I dodged a great winter bullet. And I am kind of looking forward to going back because I need to go back eventually, right? Okay, happy Channel Partners Week as well. Hopefully you're tuning in and also checking out the virtual experience at Channel Partners Online. And now getting into it, today with me, I have Roger Paschal, who is Vice President of Channels at Crown Castle. Is it Crown Castle Fiber or Crown Castle?
Crown Castle's fine. Crown Castle Fiber both work. So yes, indeed. And congratulations on the new role, Corey. Very exciting to hear that. And congratulations on being Florida, because I'm still here in Columbus, Ohio, which is beautiful right now. But a couple weeks ago, it wasn't so much.
Yes, that is the reason why I'm here in Florida, because I know a couple weeks ago it sucked. And I cannot say the same for here. Though, you know, Florida, like I joke, it's its own country. You know, people just kind of do whatever the F they want. And which is interesting, right? Some people take COVID seriously, some people don't. But now that it's starting to be spring break, it's really kind of filling up. And now I'm starting to feel not so comfortable. So I'm okay going back at this point.
Absolutely. And by the way, congrats on not being lactose intolerant.
Yeah. You know, I love cheese. Like, I have an insane love for all things cheese. So if I were lactose intolerant, boy, I don't know, I'd have a problem. Sometimes I wish I were, because it, you know, I'd lose weight.
By the way, I did bring coffee, but I have to say, you know, like we've chatted before in the past. By the way, thanks for having me on. I really appreciate it. It's an honor to be here, and it's always awesome talking to you. So, but I have to admit, I am probably just not a coffee aficionado. I probably don't know the difference between a Folgers and a $7,000 cup of Starbucks. but this is what I like right here. So in the morning, I like to do the juicing. So this is full of juice.
What is it? What juice?
So this morning, let's see, broccoli, kale, asparagus, threw in some strawberries, some tomatoes, blueberries, trying to think what else. Put in some apple juice to, you know, make it a little more palatable. I put a tennis shoe in here. by the way, it's not even juicing. It's actually blending. We say juicing, but it's blending. I would just say this to anybody right now. If you have a Costco near you, go out right now, go to the Vitamix section, buy the low end Vitamix. You don't need the one with all the crazy bells and whistles. These things are like a jet engine with a little blade attached to them. You have to wait till your neighbors wake up before you turn this thing on. But you can put anything in here. I mean, if you put like, I don't know, you fill it with ice, you know, 2 minutes later, it'll be hot water. You could, yes. Throw some rocks in there from your yard and turn it into a frothy gravy.
I have to say, I am a sucker for Vitamix demonstrations at Costco. They made me and Miles, they made Miles and I a like chocolate ice cream only using cocoa powder, but like tomatoes and all the stuff. So like we got veggies, but it was chocolate ice cream. Blew my mind.
That is cool. Well, see, that's the difference between juicing and blending. So if you're using a blender, everything's in there. I mean, you know, the rind, obviously the fruit and veggies itself, but also the seeds. I mean, it's all in here. It just kind of goes into a liquid and there you go.
Which for me, I'm more of a genuine juicer. Like give me a celery juice in the morning because I'm so basic like that. I love a good no rind, no pulp juice. Which is fascinating because I really love like a good fresh orange juice with the pulp. So sure. I'm a total paradox, but like when it comes to juice, I want it like no pulp, like no.
Yeah. No, I hear you. The good thing about the Vitamix is, I mean, you leave it on long enough. There's no pulp. I mean, I don't know what happens to the pulp, but it's amazing how it's just totally smooth and you'd be surprised what you can put in there and turns into just a nice little liquid.
I'm not sure I'm a fan of broccoli and asparagus in my juice, I have to say.
I mean, you put enough apple juice or pineapple juice or orange juice in there, you can kill any, you can gag it down, you know?
That's true. Your insides are very healthy.
Yeah, well, a friend of mine told me, he got me into it. He said it this way. He said it kind of lubricates your entire body for the whole day. I don't know exactly what that means, but.
Taco Bell does that for me.
Yes, both work equally. I'll try to put a burrito in there tomorrow morning and see what happens.
Sounds good. although people, if TBI people are listening, they would know that it's really White Castle for me. Like I love White Castle.
Headquartered here in beautiful Columbus, Ohio.
Is that true? I didn't actually know that. I mean, I never really looked into where it was headquartered.
Huh. Yeah. Here we got a lot of food, you know, chains that are headquartered here. Wendy's is another big one. That's obviously pretty huge.
Yep. So you are in Columbus. You have five kids.
Yeah, that's exactly right. Were you telling me that or asking me? I do.
I want to know how. Yeah, you're right. I was telling you.
We have a basketball team. That's exactly right. So yeah, we live in Columbus these days. We moved down here from Cleveland before that and spent almost 13 years out in Southern California. But we're originally, my wife and I, Rebecca, we're from Indiana. So our daughter goes to Ohio State. So we're Buckeyes too, but we're Hoosiers. I'm a Hoosier. But we have five kids. We could, put together a basketball team.
But, yeah. And that had to be fun. Like, what are the ages? Because, quarantine lockdown had to be a blast for you. And
yeah. Well, certainly introduced some interesting times. So we've got two in high school, two in college, one out of college. So the ages are, let's see, 14, just turned 15, just turned 22, 24, and 26. So Michael, Daniel, Noel, Holly, and our youngest, Joshua.
So what are you guys doing? What are you doing?
Well, you know, that's the thing, you know, this time of year, I tell people, you know, I spend a lot of time in lawn chairs and bleachers because, you know, whether it's, football or right now lacrosse or wrestling, which just got done, or volleyball or band or some theater event or track and field or soccer, you name it. That's kind of what we do in the winter. You catch us there most of the time. So that takes up, which is awesome. Our youngest is probably the most active. He moved from football this year to wrestling to now lacrosse. So he's like a three sport kid. He's a freshman.
Oh my gosh. Wrestling's so interesting. I was like telling you before that I heard on ESPN that the Big Ten Network's going to have like championship on this weekend or something, I think. Are you going to watch it? Is there something?
Yeah, that's so funny you asked that because it's coming up this weekend. But I would have, if you'd asked me this a couple of years ago, I would have said no. But I wasn't into wrestling as younger. I didn't wrestle, but my son's gotten into it, and over the last 3 or 4 years, and I just have developed such an appreciation for the sport. I had no idea. I mean, if you if you haven't been to a wrestling match, I would encourage you to go or, you know, check out the Big Ten Network and watch it. The level of sportsmanship, first of all, is probably the thing that to me is the most awesome part about it. Maybe the most surprising, but the other thing about it too, you know, you've got, it's obviously a physical sport. Everybody's, you know, rolling around on top of each other, trying to pin each other, but it's mostly up here. It's such a strategic sport where experience and skill is really what it's all about. And I've learned that through my son and seeing him grow in the sport. He absolutely loves it. He's getting good at it. He's a freshman, got his letter this year. So it was really exciting for him to see that. But you know, I was not exposed to that as a kid. And so I've developed an appreciation for it I never had.
That's cool. Yeah, I don't really know much about wrestling, but I know like Pete Shaw and Marco Sanchez at TBI, they have, Marco used to wrestle and Pete, I know, is his sons, or maybe just one son, is very big into wrestling. So they talk about it a lot. And I'm like, what are you talking, like, really? Who cares? But since you and I talked about it, I'm like, maybe there's something to this. I will check it out.
You want to learn discipline and dedication? Get into wrestling. That's all I'll say about that.
Well, I'm not sure I'm going to get into it, but
yeah, I'm not recommending like a wrestling league or something.
but I am going to check it out for sure. So let's get into it. Talk to the folks watching what Crown Castle does. What do you do?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I mean, no, I'm relatively new here. I haven't even been here a year and, you know, Crown Castle, a lot of people may not know what we do, may not have heard of us. You know, I say it this way, you know, if you look out your window or you drive through your town and you see one of those cell towers, there's a good chance it's a Crown Castle cell tower. We own most of them in the United States, and we have about 40,000 of them across the US. And we combine that with about 70,000 small cells. And of course, a massive fiber network, about 80,000 route miles of fiber and about 40,000 on-net buildings and connectivity to about 900 data centers around the country. And so we have this massive, unique infrastructure, and we've been building this over the last 30 years. And as a result, we leverage that really cool, unique infrastructure for some pretty neat solutions, some data communication solutions, some pretty basic things like dedicated internet access, all the way through some very complex custom built fiber based services for some of the largest companies in the world. So it's a pretty neat place to be with a pretty cool story.
Yeah. I am curious, like, where did you hail from? Like, where did you come from? Because you're, like you said, you're relatively new, but like, what drew you to Crown Castle?
Yeah. So I came here most directly from CenturyLink, which is now Lumen. And, you know, all in there, I was there for 15 years. So I was part of TW Telecom. We merged with Level 3. Then we merged with CenturyLink, which is now Lumen. So I came from an amazing company. But the thing about Crown Castle that is ultimately what I would say the most compelling for me, I kind of say it this way. When you walk through the doors here, when we could walk through the doors, can't walk through the doors right now, but soon, you just notice that there is a real culture built around the customer. It's an intentional thing. It's kind of in the DNA around here. It's, you know, it's not something we've got on a poster on the you know, in the hallway. It's the real deal, and it's intense. And you know, if you talk to our customers, you talk to our partners who work with us regularly, that's really what they talk about the most. That's the feedback you get. And partners that we work with out there, we talk about this internally all the time, that they're operating without a net, and their most precious thing that they bring to us, which is their customer relationships, you gotta treat that right. And this is really where Crown Castle shines, a real differentiated customer experience, which ties to an awesome partner experience. So that's really, I would say that's the most compelling reason why I'm here. And the thing that I just feel lucky to be here, really, because of that. We have some great people who helped build that. The other thing I'll say is it's not just me talking. We just came out of our Net Promoter Score survey process for 2020. This is where we get feedback from our customers. And there's a thing called a top box score. And that really denotes what percentage of your customers rate you a 9 or a 10, which is the top, right? 9 or 10 out of 10. And the number for us is 85%. which is pretty significant.
Your NPS score is 85%.
That's exactly right.
You guys, I'm a marketer. So a net promoter score means a lot to a business. And 85% is extraordinarily good, especially in telecommunications.
It's considered optimal for our industry. Exactly right. And so that's why I talk a lot about it. I'm passionate about it, but I always kind of like to use that too, because it's not just me talking. That's our customers.
You know, I love hearing your passion, and I love that you said you came over mainly for culture. I mean, as in addition to a product set, and we're going to talk a little bit about more where Crown is headed, but like, you hit the nail on the head so well. In the channel, independent agents, our selling partners, you know, they are operating without a net. Their reputation means everything. If they screw up on an order, it doesn't matter. The customer doesn't care whose fault it is. They don't care that the vendor screwed up. They just are looking at their advisor and they're thinking like, you did me wrong, right? And that kills business. I mean, this is their livelihood. So, you know, to have a net promoter score that's this high, to have people love you, to know you and to love you, means pretty much everything in this business.
It really does. I mean, you can have all the greatest assets and technology and services in the world. Nothing matters if you don't have that. And I like to say this, you know, we're a $6 billion company with almost an $80 billion market cap, which kind of tells you what the market and our investors think about our future. But the reason I think we're able to deliver this level of kind of a differentiated experience is we're sort of small enough that we can get out of our own way, if you will, but we're big enough to do anything we need to do on behalf of any customer. So it's a perfect mix of kind of size and power, if you will. So, but it's really the people. I mean, our number one asset is our people. I'm, like I said, I'm lucky to be here. I have a great team, and the company is full of people that I just, you know, I haven't been here even a year, and I just continue to be impressed.
I love that. It's one of the reasons why our word of the year is human, because it is the people that make the relationship so deep and prosperous, I suppose.
But yeah, and I would say, to dovetail with that, I mean, that's why we've been, I think, historically so successful with TBI. There's just quality people like working with quality people, and I'll leave it at that.
Couldn't agree with you more. Well said. So let's talk about something. You know, you mentioned wireless tower assets, DIA, but let's talk about some of your other sort of, I don't know if we call them business units, but like, I want to know where Crown Castle is taking, where are you looking to take the company as we move into more of those emerging technology solutions, and how does Crown play a part in helping some of these partners transition, right?
Yeah, well, that's a great softball question for me, because it's one of the things I'm most excited about in terms of Crown Castle. I mentioned the interest in Crown Castle from a market standpoint, from an investor standpoint. The future is white hot bright for us because of what you just said. And while we definitely provide, you know, sort of core products and services, you know, DIA, Ethernet, you know, fiber-based services, we provide some pretty high-end custom fiber solutions for customers. It's that emerging solution space that you just mentioned, which is probably the most exciting. In particular, I would say edge solutions. We have a really cool story developing, and we've been developing it for half a decade, by the way, in terms of edge solutions. And I would tell you, if you ask 100 people about edge solutions, they probably give you 100 different answers. But if you think about those assets that I mentioned, where you combine the cell towers, the small cells, the fiber network, the on-net presence, there isn't anybody out there who has this kind of an asset class. And when you think in terms of every one of those cell towers has the ability to provide a potential customer space, power, environmentals, connect that to a wireless network, connect that to fiber. We're just at the beginning of what this is all going to mean, Corey. I mean, even some customers aren't quite sure of what they need. And we're working with manufacturers, we're working with airlines, municipalities, companies looking to deploy drone type technology, you name it. It's we can't even really dream up or imagine what's going to happen in terms of the Internet of Things and what types of applications are going to be driving this kind of a need. And so we love talking to partners about it, educating them, educating their customers, because in some cases, you know, they're just not aware of what all this capability can provide. They may be reading about it. They know they need to know more about it. And that's where we can come in. And from the very beginning, solution development, design, engineering, to obviously deploying it, because this is what we do. We've been doing it for 30 years. Deploying communications infrastructure is kind of right at the heart of our DNA.
I love the passion that comes from talking about sort of the edge solutions and piecing it all together to make it a holistic solution for businesses. You know, for those that are curious to learn more, I am going to make a plug for you guys that you are participating in our Next Gen Virtual Connect on March 18th, where we are talking about cloud infrastructure, of which you're playing a part in discussing. Like all things edge and wireless.
Absolutely. You got it exactly right. Now, I would also add, you know, our rooftop infrastructure, you know, companies out there with rooftops that are between 2 and 8 stories and they're in a dense urban area, they own their building. We may have something to talk about. There's a lot of interest in putting wireless infrastructure on buildings. It can be a revenue opportunity for a potential customer to monetize their rooftop. We do that as well. And that has sparked a lot of interesting conversations with partners recently.
Yeah, it sure can be an awesome revenue generator. We have some referral partners that do just that. So yeah, I would be fascinated if anyone's like listening who wants to hear more about that. We can certainly have a discussion. All right, like switching away from work, with 5 kids, what does like free Roger time look like for you? I mean, is it like a really long honey-do list? What is it? What do you
do? No. You know, it depends. Of course, around here in Columbus, like there in Chicago, it depends on what time of year it is, right? You know, but it's, especially in the summer, things start getting a lot more loose. So, you know, we've got a little place north of here, a lake called Indian Lake, and we do boating and fishing and wakeboarding, and that's a great place to kind of bring all the kids together and their friends in the summer. And so we do a lot of that. I love the golf. I say this, I love the golf badly. I do that very, very well. I think my top 5 personal expense is golf balls. So I do that whenever I can. And, you know, my wife and I like to travel, but, you know, we haven't been able to do a lot of that lately. And you'll find one thing my wife, Rebecca, and I love to do, again, which we haven't been doing much of at all, is going to see live concerts. We love live music. We both do. And so, you know, we like that.
What kind of genre?
Oh, totally eclectic. I mean, my wife's probably more country, a more, you know, rock. We'll be at a James Taylor concert one day, the next day at a Metallica, or, you know, Guns N' Roses the next, and the next day we'll be at a Kenny Chesney kind of a concert. So it just depends. We love it all, especially outdoor concerts in the summer. We just love it.
She's a little more country. You're a little more rock and roll.
That's exactly right. I'm married to Marie.
we're like dating ourselves. These new partners are like, who are these people?
Yeah, I should have said, I don't know what you're talking about.
Right. It's fine. Okay, wait. Everyone wants to know, what are you binge watching on TV? What's on your Netflix?
Oh, wow. Yeah, I guess in the last year has been a lot of that. I would say Yeah. So some of the usual suspects, like the, you know, Ozark, you know, that's like table stakes. Yeah. That's awesome. By the way, we love that. Recently we were, Stranger Things. The kids got us into that. We watched that over last summer and just finished 3 weeks ago, Cobra Kai, which was awesome. Especially if you spend any time in the '80s. I was born in 1984. So familiar with that.
Marie.
Yeah. Oh, the other one too. And I have to tell you this, this is my personal recommendation. So what I'm about to tell you, you do not have to be involved or a fan of auto racing, but there's a docuseries out there called Formula One Drive to Survive. I am telling you what, check this out. It's on Netflix. It's got drama, intrigue. I mean, it's a world of just high stakes, glamour, money, technology, history. These racing teams have been around for decades. I mean, you got Renault, Ferrari, Mercedes. these race car drivers, it's the top 20 of in the world. They're some of the highest, you know, paid athletes on the planet. And it is competitive. There's tragedy. I mean, one day they're in Azerbaijan. The next thing you know, they're in Monaco. The next thing you know, they're in Texas. So, I mean, it's really, it's a, and the videography, they, I don't know what kind of cameras they use, but it's like the next gen of GoPro or something, because you feel like you are in the car. It's really cool.
Oh, I mean, I'm not normally like a racing fan, but like, man, your passion makes me want to check out wrestling and Formula One. Like, who am I?
Don't do those two things together, by the way.
No, that's cool. I am going to check that out, because Formula One, you know, like not so much NASCAR, but like Formula One, obviously you mentioned like money and intrigue and drama. I'm in. It's like a Bravo series.
It is amazing. I mean, and it's, and there's some tragedy involved, you know, there, this is a dangerous sport. And these guys are driving right at the edge of these cars' capability. And I mean, just the technology, there's computer scientists, there's engineers, of course, there's just, it's amazing. And they show it all to you. They expose it all.
I am going to check it out. Thanks for the recommendation. Sure. Okay. Last, we're going to wrap up. I'm curious to know, what are you excited about personally, professionally? You can answer it however you want, but what are you excited about for the year?
Well, personally, you know, I'm looking forward to, you know, hugging my parents. Haven't been able to do that in quite some time. By the way, they did just get the vaccine. And they got the Moderna, both shots. Everything's going well. My dad likes to say he can now see through cardboard. So that's exciting. You know, looking forward to doing some just more normal types of things that we haven't been able to do in quite some time. So hopefully that starts to evolve. And professionally, looking forward to getting out and actually pressing the flesh with some partners and you know, meeting my team. There's a lot of people in my team here at work I've never met. I kid them all the time that I don't even know if they have legs.
Right.
As far as I know. But you know, really that, and I would say this professionally too, you know, we have spent a lot of time at Crown Castle over the last year, putting together a new channel support team. We just this week started a brand new client support team dedicated to the channel for lifecycle management and renewals. We started a new national team focusing on some of our great partners like TBI. That's all new. So I'm looking forward to that paying dividends here in 2021 as well. So, and you know, maybe getting out to a concert or two here this summer.
Oh, I look forward to all of these things as well. This has been great. Roger, thank you so much. I've enjoyed talking with you, and personally and professionally, I look forward to when we can meet in person as well.
Awesome. Thank you for having me. Look forward to it. Thanks, Corey.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for tuning in. See you next week.